Have you ever thought about starting your own podcast? When I was trying to get this podcast off the ground, I had so many questions. How do I record an episode? Where do I find background music? How do I get my show on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and all the other places people like to listen? Where do I find advertisers? The answer to every one of those questions is really simple. Anchor. Anchor is a one-stop shop for recording, hosting, distributing, and monetizing your podcast. And best of all, it's 100% free and 100% ridiculously easy to use. Let me tell y'all. Everybody keeps asking me, what do I do to podcast? I'm telling you, the answer is Anchor. They created my RSS feed. They gave me my first two sponsors that you're now hearing on this podcast. I want you to know that I believe in Anchor. I've grown with this platform since February, and I'm going to continuously grow with this platform. So if you always wanted to start a podcast, go to anchor.fm/start to join me and the diverse community of podcasters already using Anchor. That's anchor.fm/start. I can't wait to hear your podcast. You are now listening to the Walk by Faith podcast. I'm your host, Jasmine Stith, aka The Pretty Plug. I'm on a mission to tell the lost story that combines faith in God and success here on this earth. The world often separates faith and entrepreneurship as if, y'all, as if it was mutually exclusive. But I assure you it's not. I interview the following types of people: entrepreneurs, business women and business men climbing the corporate ladder, founders of nonprofit organizations, college students following their passions, and also artists on the rise. They are movers and shakers in this generation, and I intend to plug you in week after week with content that inspires and educates you to be all that you are called to be. Thank you for tuning in, and now for this week's episode. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the second Wednesday in December. I have to thank each of you for tuning in week after week. It means the world to me to know that you will take 1 hour out of your day to just listen to what me and a guest has to say in order to encourage your walk by faith journey. Now, it has been a beautiful year with podcasting, and I just have to continue to say and thank each of you for supporting the movement. So before we get into the podcast, I have to pub for an event that Faith Tech Grow will be hosting, and it's called Boards and Brunch. It's going to be located in Whitehall, and it is at the public library. The address is 300 Anderson Ave, Whitehall, Arkansas, 71602. The event will start at 10 a.m. and it will end at 1 p.m. It is going to be on January 5th at 2018. So y'all, it's next year. So not 2018, 2019. Okay. So this event is only $25 a person. It's going to include boards, supplies, a brunch, and drinks. And guess what? We have some special guests and also some panelists. And we're going to be covering small business and personal development workshops. One of our special guests is going to be Sierra Howard. She is the founder of Young, Wild, and Financially Free. She's going to be talking to you about budgets and finance and just overall money. She also has a podcast called Don't Do Budgets Podcast. Next, we'll have Brianna Coleman. She is the founder of Prosper Consulting, LLC. She also is this girl does so much to help me produce this podcast, for just creating the Faith Tech Grow, LLC. She is the co-founder of Faith Tech Grow also. So y'all, she gonna be there giving you branding tips. And I myself will be there just talking to you about entrepreneurship, about podcasting, about having a business and what it means to like grow your team through leadership. And the last person that's going to be at this event, she's on the podcast right now, y'all. I know you're getting excited. If you've read our flyer and if you've been following us on social media, you'll know who I'm talking about. But please get your tickets at faithtechgroweventsmart.com. I told you that we had a guest today, and she is none other than a woman who I had the pleasure of meeting when I was around 15 years old at Pine Bluff High School. We danced together. We was on a drill team. She was always like this big sister. She had all this wisdom and this knowledge, and I used to always hear her talking about God. And I was just like, man, who is this woman? You know, I had the pleasure of being around her, especially like during band and dancing, but I've just watched her evolve over time. She now is a vlogger, and she is Rhondafully made, and she is changing lives one vlog at a time. So the guest on this podcast is none other than LaRhonda Glover. LaRhonda, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm good. LaRhonda, I'm so happy to have you on the show. Like, you inspire me. I've always just looked up to you, and just I've just watched you grow, girl. Like, just into a woman, into a mom, into an entrepreneur, into a spiritual leader. Like, I'm so excited to do this event in January. And I know that you're going to touch so many women's lives, not only at that event, but just in general. And you already touched so many people's lives. So one thing that I always ask my guests, and I like to just have an icebreaker. LaRhonda, tell us three things that you have noticed about people when they are struggling to find their purpose.
Well, you know, for sure. First of all, can I just say one little thing before I answer?
Girl, yes.
So, I thank God for you, and you know, thank God for all of the sweet things that you said. But I too have watched you evolve. Okay, because you look, I'm on your podcast. I'm a guest on your show. So you have like leveled up in ways that I'm trying to get to. I'm aspiring to. So thank you for just being who you are and boldly being who you are and just being unafraid to do what God's calling you to do as well. So, you know, that's iron sharpening iron right there. But to answer your question, you know, what I think about when people are struggling to find their purpose, you know, a lot of people are different, and you have to just know, first of all, I think you have to know who you are. Because a lot of people, they're looking for, you know, what my purpose is, but they don't even know who they are within themselves. So it's kind of difficult to try to find your point of existence when you don't even know who you are as a person. You know, you may have an idea of who you want to be, but does that translate to who you actually are? And, you know, one of the things that I feel like, you know, they don't know who they are, and then they don't know how to get to where they're trying to go. So, like, when you're dealing with your purpose, you know, that's kind of like your end game. But you have to, it's a journey to get there, if that makes sense. And so I think a lot of people, they struggle with, why am I here? Because they don't know who they necessarily are yet. Because if you take the time to find out who you are, your purpose will be revealed in that. Because 9 times out of 10, your purpose is all of who you are and who God created you to be. And that is what your purpose is. Me being me, I'm fulfilling my purpose. My personality with the things that God has put in me. And the more I evolve and the more that I find who I am in Him, the more I realize what my purpose is. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. And I just, a lot of people are like, you know, I just don't know why I'm here. I've got a job, or I went and got this degree, and I'm just still confused. Mm-hmm. You know, like, when you do sit down and take that time, like, what are you looking for? Is it like your characteristics? Like, are you taking a personality quiz? Like, are you just looking at your spiritual gifts? Like, what is it that you can do tangibly to like really hone in on your purpose? Because it's not that hard. But if you haven't found out your purpose, you may not have failed enough.
I think that's good too. And I think everything that you said qualifies, because I have taken a personality test. I think that's kind of important so you can get a gist of who you are, you know, the type of thing that goes along with what I was saying. You know, when you're dealing with purpose, you know, it does it's very important to know what your spiritual gifts are, searching those things out. If you know that you're, as far as personality traits, if you know you're an alpha female, well, research that out. See what that's like. See, you know what type of things that alpha female does, or whatever it is that you find out about yourself. You know, those are very tangible things. Like, I think you named all that I've done. And then when you went so far to say, you know, what exactly, because I don't want to misquote you. What did you just say about?
I was just saying that you haven't failed enough. Yeah, you haven't failed enough. If you don't know your purpose, you probably haven't failed.
Exactly. And because a lot of, another thing with that too is, you know, a lot of times our purposes are way grander than what we think it is. And it requires a lot more than what you can actually think. You know, my pastor said all the time, you know, like if it's small, it ain't God. You know, if it's on a small scale, God probably, or if you can do it in your own strength, God probably didn't tell you to do it. So, you know, I think that everything that you said is very important and very tangible things that you could do to help you find your purpose.
Okay. And just speaking about God, like I said, LaRhonda, when I first met you, you were talking about him nonstop. You know, it was in your walk. It was in your talk. It was in the very essence of your being. And you were even leading like the choir at Palm Bluff High. Like you was just getting it, you know. And I always just wanted to know, like, when did God first find you, and when did you accept him into your life? And when, like, what was that exchange and that building of that relationship? When was that pivotal moment when you said yes to God?
Oh, well, you know, I grew up in the church, and that's one thing I'm very grateful for my mom about. I grew up in church, and so I always knew that God was real. I was baptized. I think I might have been 8 years old, you know, but God became really real for me back in like 2006. When I went to a Always Sisters conference, Always Sisters, Always Friends, Cece Winan had this conference every year in Nashville. And it was thousands of girls from all across the country that was there. We had like a lot of mini sessions, worship sessions, you know, pastors came, famous pastors came to preach, you know, and I was like, this is real. And something happened. I like really had what they call it, a come to Jesus meeting. I really had one of those there. It was, I experienced God in the realest way for the first time there. And I was like unafraid. I was praising God, unashamed. And at that point I was like, okay, God is real. But then how do you translate that? Because in 2006, I was what, 12 years old, something like that. How did that translate to, still being a teenager, still being cool and still being popular? And sometimes I struggle with that. But, you know, one thing that the Bible says, you know, you train up a child in the way they should go. When they get older, they don't depart from it. And so I did sometimes wild out a little bit, you know, when I got to college and throughout high school. I didn't always make the right decisions, but I could never go so far because God was still the center of my heart. He was still rooted. So I say back in 2006, that's when I was like, really like, okay, God is for real. This experience is real. God is seriously real. Yeah, I would say back at that conference, that changed my life forever. And I thank God for Cece Winan for even doing that, because it helped me. But everybody that I went with, we kind of had our own experience with God then. So it was amazing. But yeah, that was back about 12 years ago. Wow, that seemed like a long time ago. But that was about 12 years ago.
Listen, we still young. You know, black don't crack.
I know.
Girl, we going to be 50-something. They going to be like, girl, is that your sister? Yes, it is. We are sisters. We young. We young, pretty young things. So yes. I want to talk about why you started vlogging and you developed this brand called Rhondafully Made. So what does Rhondafully Made do? What does she talk about? What is your vlog about? Just spill the tea. Okay. Listen, I believe the phrase is catch the tea. Uh-huh. Okay.
Uh-huh. So, you know, Rhondafully Made, the name of it is a play on, being fearfully and wonderfully. I can't even say it no more now. Fearfully and wonderfully made. And my name is Rhonda. So of course that's the play on that. But, Rhondafully Made is a vlog, and Everybody can take away from it. And when I first started it, it was for everybody. And it's just for holistic wellness, really, in every area of your life. We want you whole and entire, lacking nothing in every area of your life. And that's emotionally, financially, spiritually, emotionally, like every area. And then as I started vlogging, I would talk about different things. What started it, the start of it was this social media. I would look on Facebook and Insta, well, more so on Facebook, and I had saw like, my heart was literally like aching at some of the things that I would see on Facebook. And it was like, we had lost. And I say we, this generation, especially this generation of young women, we have lost the sense of class, tactfulness, in everywhere that I can think of, accountability. It's like all, you know, all restraint is off. You can do whatever, you can say whatever. Nothing is private anymore. Nothing is sacred anymore. It's okay to talk about sex, what you do in your bedroom publicly. Like, that's okay. It's okay to be half naked and everybody, you'll get 1,000 likes if you do it. It's like everything has become socially acceptable. And I'm like, where is the standard? Have we lost everything? Like, do we not have morals and values anymore? Like, what happened? What has happened to everywhere? Everyone is desensitized to like morals. Like, don't nobody, it seemed like a lot of it, we were lacking it. And I was like, God, well, what can I do? You know, because I don't have it all together. I make mistakes. I'm not perfect by any stretch of imagination, but you know, I do have a little something that you gave me. So what do I do? And I had prayed about it for a little bit. Long story short, I was actually getting my hair done one day and I was talking to my beautician and she was like, well, why don't you start a YouTube channel or something like that? And I was like, no, I don't want to do no YouTube. And then, you know, I was like, well, God, what do I do? Because, you know, and he kind of pretty much gave me this vlog. And so we deal with, it started for everybody. And I believe if a man watched it, he could, you know, benefit from it. But then it became more geared toward young women between like ages of 18 to 35.
Yeah.
And it's just to let you know, hey, boo, you don't have to settle. You know, you can be like in this generation, you can be relevant, you can be saved, you can be savvy, you can be everything that you want to be, and you don't have to compromise who you are to be it. You don't have to compromise, period. You don't have to compromise on anything to be socially accepted. And so we just delve into different things. We talk about relationships. We talk about God, because again, I'm not a one-sided, it's not a one-sided vlog. We deal with motherhood. We deal with everything because we want you to be whole in every area that, you know, of your life.
Yeah. And I think, you know, some people like, you know, what makes you qualified to help other people? I feel like you have a true calling on your life, LaRhonda, and that God really does speak to you and through you. And I just want to speak on that, just more so being a young Christian, or, you know, taking God seriously and not waiting until you 50 years old. You know, can God use you at a young age? Can he speak through you at a young age? Why don't more people believe that you can love God, be young, and have a purpose-filled life? You don't have to wait until you're old.
Because that, you know, and I don't know, let me just put this disclaimer out. I don't know all the answers. I don't have all the answers. I can just give you my opinion for those who listen, because I don't want anybody to think, well, she thinks she know it all. But no, this is just my experience and my opinion of it. I think that we have done church traditionally for so long that that's how we feel. So like, okay, mama and grandma and them, they kicked it. And then when they got older, they start going to church. But they went to the club, they did all of that, or they did. They were still going to church, they were still going to the club. They were still, like, there was no separation. There was no consecration. There was no sanctification. There was no, okay, I'm living for God, I'm sold out to God. It was always, you know, crossing the boundaries. Like, you lukewarm. Like, you go to church, but you're still, you know, doing your own thing. And so now that has become the norm, especially in a lot of Black churches. So, in my opinion, from what I see. And so, you know, it was different because I remember, and speaking for myself, I remember being a kid thinking, well, My mama making me go to church now, but when I get older, I'm a kicky. I'm going to turn up and I'm going to do everything I want to do. And then I'm going to do like what I saw when I got in church. I'm with kids. I'm, you know, in my late 30s, early 40s. And then that's when I get serious about God after I've done everything that I wanted to do. And that's why I thank God so much for that conference, because God said, no, you're going to do what I need you to do now. And that's why I'm sold out to God now. But I think a lot of times, you know, that's what society and tradition tells us, is that it's okay to, you know, live your best life in your 20s. That's when you're supposed to be living free and da 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 da. And then when they say that, they don't use wisdom with that. And so they, you know, you literally take their 20s to wild out. And then when they're broken, or, you know, they've had too many relationships that didn't work, or they hit rock bottom, or, you know, when the high life has hit a low, then they come back to God. It's like, okay, God, I messed up. And which he's right there to catch you and right there in love on you. But we don't always have, we don't never have to take that route. We can just stay with him the whole time and really live a high life through him.
Yes. And when you mention relationships, LaRhonda, I know you know a thing or two about them. And girl, you really helped me. You know, you opened my eyes in some areas. It was some things I was like, nah, I ain't about to do that.
Right.
I mean, I was just like, woo. I was even watching one of your vlogs, and you were just talking about compromise. But when it comes to dating, a lot of us lack just the knowledge on what it takes to become the person that God has called us to be before we find our other half. You know how people be like, oh, I'm bringing my 50%, they bringing their 50%, or that person is my other half. I've learned it got to be 100-100. Okay. It can't be no 50-50.
That's right.
But I want to know, what have you learned about dating, and what can you just shed light from, both like just for people that are wanting love, because we're going into 2019 and people putting on their vision board, I want, you know, my Barack Obama, or I want my whatever your relationship goal may be. And I remember just hearing you say, you know, we need more rings in 2019.
Yeah, we do.
So I just want to get your take on relationships, and we can just play on that. We could probably go all day. Well, you know, what's your take?
Yeah. I just think that, you know, first of all, as far as relationship goals, you know, it's okay to have a goal, but, you know, let's not aspire to be like somebody else, because you don't know what they had to go through to get to where they are. So, you know, I think it's okay to have, like, you know, goals, but let's just be realistic. You have to put in the work. And when it comes to relationships, for me, compromise and proper communication, that's like the top two. Because especially, well, just even dating, I had to have that before my husband and I even got married, just dating. You know, it's different types of compromises that you have. You know, it's different compromises from when you're dating, and it's different compromises when you're married. And I think one thing that we always have to, especially to my dating sisters and brothers, a lot of times we get caught up, especially when we're in a relationship where we really love somebody or we really care for them, we try to make marriage compromises in a dating situation. And that is a big no-no, in my opinion. Like, you don't make compromises like you're married when you're dating. That's when lines get crossed, and, you know, certain relationships require certain benefits. You know what I'm saying? So if you're dating, you get the dating benefits, not dating and getting married benefits. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes when we cross those lines, you know, that kind of ruins certain things for us. Because, you know, like the old saying, you know, why buy the cow when you get the milk for free? You know, when you start doing things out of context, or you start doing things out of order, and it's not just about sex, because I know a lot of people, that's what they'll probably think about. That's just one. That's a big aspect, but that's just one aspect of doing married things in a dating relationship. Like, I'm not doing your laundry. I'm not cooking for you. Like, I, you know, like, not like that. Now, special occasions, your birthday, I might cook for you. You know, certain things I might cook for you, but I'm not going to cook a meal every single day for you to come and eat. I'm not doing it. I do that as your wife, but I can't do that as your girlfriend. I'm not going to wash all your clothes all the time. I'm not your wife. I'm not your mother. So, you know, certain like little things like that, that people could take for granted easily and be like, well, you know, that's what she holding me down. That's what she do. Okay. But she's also playing your wife, which is probably why y'all been dating for the last 7 years and she don't have a ring yet. So it's just like, you know, certain things like that. And so, and now those are compromises, but then proper communication, you have to be upfront and honest about, you know, what you want, what you're willing to accept, and just being open and honest with that person. Because if you're open and honest, it'll save a whole lot of heartbreak and lies and betrayal. And that's how you build trust. Because, you know, people say, you know, without trust, you have nothing. But how do you build that trust? You have to communicate. You have to show yourself trustworthy. And how do you do that? Through proper communication. So I know that those things are very important to this day to my marriage. Like, yes, I love my husband and we trust each other implicitly, but that communication is, that is proper communication. Proper communication. That is the kicker. That's the winner for me. That's how you do it. Properly communicating. Because, you know, statistically, you know, a lot of marriages, I think, and I don't want to get the statistics wrong, but I think the last time I looked, like 80 to 90% of marriages fail because of money. And to me, that's a communication issue too. Like it all boils down back to communication. If you properly communicate about how you're going to do your finances, if you properly communicate about, okay, are we mutually exclusive? You know, are you trying to do an open relationship? What are we seeing other people? Are we just dating? What is your expectation of me? You know, are we obligating one another to each other? You know, what is this that we're doing? When we properly communicate and we set everything out on the table, everything is guaranteed to flow smoothly if you are open and honest and communicating. So that's what I think. Did I answer your question?
You did. Okay. And I wanted to now know your love story with your husband, because you said y'all dated on purpose.
We did. We dated on purpose. And the short of it is, I graduated from Palm Pilots, you know, and then I went to Fayetteville. And I ended up moving back home. The Lord told me I can to move. He did not. I can. He told me to move back to Pine Bluff. And I was like, okay. So I moved back. I joined Full Council Church. Shout out to Pastor Vincent Johnson, Bishop Silas Johnson, and Lady Jennifer Johnson. I had to put that little plug in there. Best church in the world. And I joined the church. And the church was on fire. And I was like, God, you know, before I even moved back, I came home one weekend and I visited the church and I was like, okay, this church is dope. And I had an urgency to join then. And I was like, no, because I'm active in church. You know, I live in Fayetteville. This don't make sense. I don't even have a car to get back and forth like I want to. So I'm not going to join. So I went back home. And one night I was in prayer. I was fed up with a lot of different things that was going on in my immediate life. And I was like, well, God, what do you want me to do? You know, if you give me an opportunity to go back to that church or go back home the very next time, I'm going to join. And within 7 days of me praying that, the Lord had told me to go home, and I was back living in Pine Bluff, period. So when I got to the church, the Sunday that I joined, I saw this man on the stage in worship, on his knees, worshiping God. And I was like, who in the heck is that? Like, who is it? Who is it? And, you know, and I knew he was older, and I didn't see a ring on his finger. So I immediately kind of like dismissed it as, you know, that's just a little crush. But I love, you know, I love his swag, and I love how he is in front of this entire church and he don't care. And he is worshiping God, and he, you know, just in his own world. Fast forward. We end up talking one day, and he came in my life as a mentor. And he was giving me that word. I mean, he was feeding me that word. And I was growing, and I saw how my life had changed. Like, with him just sending me the word every morning, you know, praying with me, talking to the word. Like, he would send me text, you know, he'll text me some passages to read. Then we'll talk about it later. And it was just, and I was like, yes, I'm really understanding this stuff. Okay, this is it. Well, then that conversation started changing from just word to, what you doing today? you know, at first it was just we hitting each other up just on some what God said. And then it went from that to like, okay, you know, what you doing today? You know, what you eating? You know, how was work? And so then it went from that to, okay, I started liking him. And I remember telling him, you know, don't call me, don't text me. Because I was 19, he was 31 at the time. And I was like, you know, you're not feeling, I know you're not feeling me like that. I'm probably look like a little girl to you or like a little sister or whatever. Because, you know, he never tried to talk to me. And as a matter of fact, when we first started communicating, he told me, this is in no attempt to try to talk to you. I'm not trying to court you or anything like that. This is just strictly platonic. And I was like, you know, of course, I didn't think he was looking at me like that. And then I started liking him. So I was like, you know, don't call me. I can't talk to you on no friendly type stuff because you're not going to make me look like no fool. And so, you know, I told him, don't call me. Don't text me unless it's about the word and God. And he came up to where I was and was telling me, hey, I like you too. So let's see where this go. So he was a member of kind of like, he wasn't an elder, he was a leader in the church, and I had just joined, and we was like, okay, well, before we do anything else, let's see what the Lord said, because I had just moved back to Pine Bluff, and I didn't come, and I was in kind of end of the 2.5 year relationship. I didn't come to find no man. I came to see what God called me to the city to do, because I know I was called back and to serve God totally. I didn't come here to get distracted by no man, by nothing else. I just wanted to do what God was calling me to do, because I know for a fact that he called me, he told me to come back home. So I wasn't trying to get caught up in a relationship and get distracted again. So I was like, no, yeah. God, you're gonna have to help me. So we went on a fast, a 3-day fast, and on the end of the third day, both of us had heard from the Lord, and the Lord had told me, he had told me that that was my husband. Well, I never mentioned a word to him that God told me that, because in the dream, because I didn't want him to think I was crazy. And I didn't know if I was crazy yet, because I was still trying to decipher the Lord's voice for mine. So I was like, you know, I think I got the right, you know, to go ahead to date. And he said he had got to go ahead to date. So then our next step was like, let's go to our pastor to see how we would date, because we want to do this the right way. And my pastor was like, you know, it's a difference between secrecy and privacy. And, you know, you don't want to be a secret, but you do want to have some privacy until you guys know that you want to date publicly. Because when you announce that you're dating publicly, all kind of claims are going to come up, you know, what he used to do, what she used to do. And if you're still learning each other and you're still trying to get to know one another, you don't want anybody to disrupt that process. You give each other the opportunity to be open and honest with each other. And then if y'all decide that y'all like each other, then good. But if y'all decide it won't work, y'all don't have too many people in your mix, you know, trying to, you know, yeah. But you know, she was talking to him, you know, it's just until y'all come, if y'all decide to come out, make sure you're going to be a strong, united front, because, you know, people going to try to shoot arrows at you. And that was the best advice that we could have ever gotten, and advice that I give people to this day. So we dated for a year without people knowing. We walked right past each other in church, but you better believe when church was over, he picking me up, we finna go get something to eat, we going to Little Rock, we going to the movies, we going on a date, we doing something. We probably was together that Saturday night, you know, kicking it or whatever. But we didn't, nobody really know unless you were close to either of us or whatever. You know, I had gone down to his family reunion and everything, and people, we walking right past each other in church, folks don't have a clue. And so we were able to date all of 2012, and then we got married in 2013. And so, you know, I think that one of the things, and he is my best friend, and God, in his infinite wisdom, you know, designed him for me and me for him. And God knew that my husband is 12 years older than me. And God knew when I was 19 and Sam had turned 32, that I was going to need him to be this way. And he was going to need me to be my 19-year-old self. And then when I, you know, as we matriculated through our marriage together, we've grown together. We've both been what we needed for each other. And he's never once tried to act, you know, ask me to be somebody I'm not. I know he's 38 now. I'm 26. I know I'm not 38, and I don't try to act 38. I'm 26, and I'm going to act 26. And I don't expect him to try to act my age. No, you be who we need. You know, you be who you are so we can be who we need to be for each other. And that's another part of communication. Because at first I was a little intimidated by that, honestly, because I was like, you know, I don't want him to think I'm this little kid. But at the same time, you know, I know that God called us to each other. So that's my little love story in a 5-minute nutshell.
It's beautiful. And I think it has some nuggets, right? Like, keep it to yourself and your family. Mm-hmm. You know, don't be on the ground flaunting it. Because I've been a victim of that, right? Like, right. I'm like, man, me and this dude going to be together forever. Mm-hmm. And it'd be like, nah. Mm-hmm. You know?
Because I'm going to tell you.
And then you got to go and delete pictures. It'd exactly. be so tragic.
Let me tell you. My pastor could not have been more right, because as soon as we came, so we actually, people didn't know that we were dating until he had bought me a BMW for Valentine's Day.
I remember seeing that. Yeah. I was all on Facebook.
So people was like, they were like, what? Because we had been dating since like December 2011. And they didn't know. So when he got me the car in 2012, they was like, or 2013, I don't even remember when it was, whatever year it was. Whenever he got me that car, everybody was like, what? And then shortly after the car, we were engaged. But they don't know that it was a whole year that we had been together, and they just didn't know. They came in on the end of it, and it looked like, were they rushing into something? I mean, people was accusing me of being pregnant. That's why we were trying to get married. People wow. were accusing me. I mean, all kinds of stuff, that I was just trying to get a meal ticket. Like, everything that my pastor said, wow. like the darts came. You know, people would try to tell me stuff that he did in high school. And I'm like, bro, this man been out of high school. He just said, okay, this year he celebrated his 20th class reunion. So his 20-year class reunion. So are you telling me something that this man did 15 years ago? Like, yeah. you want to be held to the standard, the person that you was 15 years ago. Okay, cool. Right. You know, so, it, you know, everything that he said, but it was nothing that they could tell me, because he had already told me. He had already told me that.
Yeah.
In that year of dating and getting to know each other. So that you don't have to tell everybody everything for something to be successful, or you don't have to have validation from nobody. As long as you have validation from God, that's all you need.
Yeah. I agree completely. I've taken another approach. I ain't telling nobody nothing. Y'all gonna see me on the ground when I got the ring. Y'all be like, what happened?
Exactly.
You should have listened to the podcast. I would have told you ain't gonna see nothing. That's exactly what it is. So what are some things that, you know, we as women should be looking for in a man?
Well, I think that, you know, that's kind of particular to who you are as a woman. You know, I know mm-hmm. myself, I needed somebody strong, because I'm a strong woman. And I needed somebody that's not going to be intimidated by my strength. And then I need somebody who loved God, first of all, and not in the way where I just go to church. I need somebody that loves God because I love God. So I think it depends on the type of woman that you are. It depends on the type of man that you need. But for me, I needed a man who really loved God, and who really loved God more than he could possibly love me. Because if you love God more than you love me, then you're going to treat me right. You got to. Because yeah. that's the Bible say that you're going to love me. The Bible say, oh, you know, husband loves your wife like God loved the church, who would die for her. So I'm like, okay, well, if you love God, then surely you're going to do his word and love me the way I needed to be loved. And that's, you know, that's a key part in our marriage too, God. And that keeps us from going at each other's throat when there might be a time where I might want to go at his throat. I can't, because God is the center of it. So we have to go back. I can't act the donkey like I used to would, because, you know, God is the center. So I have to, and he is that, the Holy Spirit to check you and be like, hey, you running out. So, you know, he has to be godly. He has to be strong. He has to be intelligent. And not just smart, but intelligent. He has to be able to adapt to change and do it seamlessly. You have to be motivated to work. Whether it's a 9-to-5 or you're trying to build something, whatever it is you want to do, I got your back, but you got to be motivated to do something, because I'm not going to take care of you.
Yes, Lord. I'm
not going to take care of you. Not in that sense anyway. I'm going to always hold you down and have your back. But I'm never going to take care of you and you're not doing anything. And I think if you have somebody that's just an honest person with that, and I don't think that that's a long laundry list of things. I think that that's a basic list. Because if you ask the guy, well, what should they be looking for? They can give you a laundry list of things that they want in a woman. But what are you bringing to the table? So I think sometimes women, we need to be, you know, and don't look at what you want right now. And I think that's a lot of times where we mess up too, because we see the right now and think that that's all it is. You know, no. If you commit yourself to this person, well, what can he be for you? What do you see yourself doing with this person in the next 5 years? Can you see yourself still with him? And how do you think he will be in the next 5 years? Like, you have to ask yourself these questions as well. So, but for me, you got to be strong. You got to love God. You got to love me. And you got to be intelligent and motivated to work. Because I can't do nothing with you without it.
Yes, Lord. Mm. So we do have some questions from the listeners. And you guys, when I feel that there's a topic that I really want you all to like chime in on, and feel free on any topic to chime in. But I asked my Instagram, my social media, I was just like, hey, y'all, like, got somebody that's really, you know, has some great dating advice. What would you want answered? And one of the listeners said, why does it take men longer to mature or arrive at the point of settling down?
Ooh. You know, I don't want to, you know, well, first of all, I think it's scientifically proven that women mature faster than men. So I think that's, we got them beat scientifically, period. But then two, I think especially in the African-American community, and that's all I can speak of because that's all I've dated. I think some of it is generational curses. I'm like, honestly, because, you know, either you see, and I don't want to, I just say this, you can see men loving their wives and stuff, but they might still mess around on a granddaddy. They was married 45 years, but he cheated 35 of the 45, and the last 10 was when he chilled out when he was 65. And then it's like, that's you see that, and it's like that's the way to go. Like it's okay to just kind of do what you do until you tired of doing it. I don't know. And then the other part is, I think that they may feel like they are missing something or will be giving up something to settle down, that they'll be losing freedom or they'll be losing. I don't know. But I think there is some fear there, because that will literally mean that you have to grow up and think about somebody other than yourself. Now, I'm not a man, so I can't give 100% whatever on that. But I think it's multifaceted. I think it may be generational curses. They've never seen somebody do it, or what they did see was not the right thing to do, or they don't want to give up freedom or whatever it is, their status, or they don't want to be tied down to one person. So when they're ready to do it, it may be 40 years old, which we may have to learn to appreciate it if they're, you know, we wait till they're ready, and that way they may be done with games. And I'm not saying if you're with somebody who's not ready, you wait. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying get the man whenever he's ready, but you don't have to stay for that process, if that makes sense. But is that clear?
Yeah, that makes so much sense. Okay. And we got another question. People love to talk about love. And it's crazy because it's like, I guess it's an industry that is just like the unknown. It's just like, we should just be, one, loving people in a healthy and happy way. But it just seems so complicated. So the second question is, how did you know you were ready for a relationship versus working on yourself alone? Or how do you know when you're ready to, you know, push towards a relationship versus just being by yourself? Because, you know, they say you gotta, whatever you want in a person, you gotta become that person, right? So how do you know when you're ready to step on out and you know, Stella got her groove back? How do you get back in there?
Well, you know, my experience is a little different because I met my husband at 19 and I got married at 20. So everything that I've done and finding myself and finding out who I am, I've done it in my marriage. And God has graced my husband to deal with me while I do it. And so it's been kind of seamless. But I think for a woman who's dating and or who, if she's trying to figure out if she's ready versus working on herself alone, you know, and it's going to take a real serious come to Jesus situation with yourself. You're going to have to keep it so real with yourself, because if you've gone through relationships, or it don't even have to be multiple relationships, if you've gone through a relationship that really hurt you to the core and you know you lost part of yourself in that, if you're really honest with yourself, you know that you need to work on that. You need to work on yourself. And that's part of what Rhondafully Made is all about, rebuilding yourself holistically. Because like I said, it's like, if you know, if you I likened it to having a gourmet meal, steak, potatoes, broccoli, wine, your favorite rolls, or whatever your favorite meal is, and you're handing it to your man on a trash can lid.
Ooh. Ho-ho.
It's like, what is this trash? You gonna give me all of this good stuff, but you giving it to, like, it's the foundation of it is garbage, literally. Like, I don't want this. It looks good on the outside, but when you get down, it kind of looks like a tray covered in food. But once you push back all of that food, it's trash. It's a trash can lid. And you don't want to present someone your trash. So you have to be real with yourself to know, okay, I'm broken in this area. I'm really codependent. I'm very needy, or whatever it is. He took a part of my self-esteem when he left. I'm intimidated about this right here. Whatever it is, you're going to have to be completely honest with yourself during that process to even think about dating. You have to be real and take the necessary steps to heal. Because if you don't heal, you're going to just keep piling stuff up on that trash can lid. And before you know it, if you get something that's unstable and you just put a whole lot of stuff off on top of it, it's going to topple over. And you're going to have a really big mess. You're going to have a really big mess. Wow. And so I think that you know when you need to work on things. Like myself. Like I said, I had to deal with things in my marriage. I had to deal with myself growing up and maturing while I was married. I didn't have the opportunity to be away from somebody and then kind of do it. No, I had to do it together. But I just had to have a meaningful. You got to boss up. Like you slack. Yeah. You slacking and you making excuses. And it doesn't have nothing to do with me, you know, my self-esteem or anything like that. It was sometimes being, you know, fulfilling my duties as a wife. Yeah, you are tired, but guess what? You're not the only tired wife. So you need to boss up and don't let them clothes sit on the couch for more than a day. Yeah, okay, you put them on the couch after dry today, but tomorrow they need to be folded before lunch because I work from home. You know, so like just having like little talks with yourself and bossing up. Like, you know, that's one isolated, you know, example. But a woman knows when she needs to, when she's been hurt. And if you got to go to therapy, ain't nothing wrong with Jesus in therapy. God created the therapist too. Go see somebody. And it don't make you less of a woman to go do it. And then when you are ready and you feel whole and you got the okay from the Lord to step out, then step out. But until then, sometimes God will intentionally not allow things to work out when he's trying to have your attention. When he wants you to do something and he's trying to get you, won't nothing work out. Ooh. And then sometimes he's having you to work some things out within yourself. He might be having you to, you worried about a man when he's trying to get you to start a multi-million dollar company. And your man that he has for you, you're going to run into him while you're building your company. But you're worried about trying to get out there on the dating scene, and God won't let none of that stuff work out. And that leads to this, and then I promise I'm getting back on this. You know, sometimes rejection is protection. When things don't work out, it's just God protecting you from certain situations and certain things. Some things you shouldn't even have to heal from. Some things we go through, and God was like, I've been trying to get you out of there for 5 years. But since you want to stay, now I'm going to have to start the process, the healing process all over again. But anyway, I'm sorry. But, you know, a woman knows.
Girl, you talking.
And a man knows.
Let me Yes, and that's just another thing for us ladies, right? Like, we can't expect more from a man than we are willing to put in for ourselves as well. You know, you have to come to the table with something.
Exactly.
And I learned that you need to write down what you would like in someone, your wants and your needs from a physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, relational, whatever you would like to have. If put in a wants and a needs in that category, and then guess what? Whatever you put on that list, you need to be able to boss up and do those things as well. You
Exactly.
know, because relationships are work. They are. They
They
are
are.
not a part-time job. They are full-time.
Every
You on
time.
the clock 24/7 unless you go to sleep, and that's a work.
Period.
Yeah. Okay.
Period.
Period. But I want to kind of just, because we're nearing the end of the podcast, but I want to bring about something that I think is so important because we're going into 2019, but a lot of us may not have a church home. A lot of us may not be plugged in to a community of people that will pray for us, that will love us, you know, that will accept us for our flaws, but work with us in order to overcome those things within ourselves that we need to change. You
Absolutely.
know, one thing about me, I've moved many places, but I've
Yes,
always
you have.
found a church.
Right.
You know, and that ain't, I think that's just God. He said, nope, you ain't gonna be here that long. Nope, you ain't gonna be there
Right.
that long. But I was just talking with a young lady yesterday. She said, what is church for? Like, what's the purpose of it? And I was like, ah, you know, she had said she had church hurt. But overall, I just want to know from your perspective, what are churches really meant for? And why should people really take that initiative to stay committed to a place where they can be fed daily with their spiritual and into their spiritual souls?
Oh man, church is an empowerment zone, period. Church is to empower the body of believers. And to me, that's what the church is. It's to be empowered, recharged. When I leave out of the presence of God, like when I leave out of there and I hear from heaven, from, via my pastor, I feel like I can take over the world. And it's so vital to be connected to a ministry where is a real ministry is actually taking place, for multiple reasons, because I know that I'm supposed to be a full council church. And the reason why I know I'm supposed to be there is because there's not one time that I go to church and I'm dealing with something and I've talked to God about it. Sometimes I don't even talk to my husband about it. I solely talk to God about it. And then I get to the church and my pastor is preaching on that thing every time. Or I'm trying to make a life decision and I get instruction on how to do it. And I didn't have to pay nobody to do it. I didn't have to do none of that. I just went and did the word. And it's an empowerment zone. When I leave, I feel refreshed. And that's what it's for. It's to empower you to prosper. It's to empower you to help other people prosper. It's to empower you to advance the kingdom of God throughout the earth. It's to empower you. And I think it is so needed. And it's to fellowship together with other believers, to empower each other. And I think that it is so vital. And you said that she was dealing with church hurt. And I may have a very unpopular opinion with church hurt, but I think that I can understand how somebody can have their feelings hurt in the church. I can understand that. I'm not trying to invalidate anybody's feelings about, have their feelings hurt in church. But I feel like, we always want to make sure that what our focus is when we go to church. Yes, we go to congregate and enjoy each other's fellowship, but my primary reason is to go and serve God, and nobody can make me not want to go to church because of that fact. Like I'm going. I love God so much that it's not a devil in hell can stop me. It's not a person on this earth that can make me change my mind about it. I'm going to church. I'm going to love God and I'm going to give God everything I have every time I go to church. I'm going to worship Him in spirit and in truth, and I'm going to live as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. I'm going to do the work. I'm going to make sure that when somebody see my life, they're going to be like, oh, she loved God for real and glorify God because of it. They're like, oh, I want to serve a God like that. And I learned that going to church and being empowered. And that's how I can sit before a non-believer or a group of believers who may be shaky and be like, yo, Jesus is the way. And I can stand flat foot and let you know that 10 toes down, Jesus is the way. So I think that, you know, and a lot of times, because church has gotten a bad rap as being like a social club, and some churches have turned it into it. But one thing that I know about God, I know it to be true. If you seek him, it won't be hard to find him. If you say, God, where do I need to go? Send me to the right church to where I can hear from you clearly. And I know that you're there, because every church is open. It's not ordained by God. Every church that's got their doors open saying, come on and serve God with me, that don't mean that God is there. So seek God and be like, where do you want me to go? And I guarantee you that he will send you where you need to be. So that's my take on that. And for sister girl who have church hurt, if she listened to this, I just want to tell you, you know, there's no hurt that God can't heal. And just remember that we don't wrestle with flesh and blood. The Bible says that we don't wrestle with the people that we see, but it's a spiritual. We wrestle with a demonic force. And sometimes people are influenced by those spirits. So it's never the person. It's always the spirit. And so don't allow that spirit to get you on offense and keep you from the house of God. Go find you a church and get in there and love on God all the more.
Yes, I can agree. You know, we have to be around people that are coming from a holistic perspective with things. You know, I feel so much love when I'm going to a church now. It's called C3 NYC. Mm-hmm. I feel so much love at that church. People are genuinely like, they'll pray for you. You know, we have dinner parties. You know, it feels like an actual family. Like when I go we had Ollie in yesterday. I knew so many people at church, and I was like, you know what? It feels like Pine Bluff just a little bit, or it feels like college just a little bit, you know? And I think that's important, because I'll be honest, like in a place that you're not even supposed to be meeting God in New York City, I feel like I'm closer now with him than I ever have been. And it's crazy. Like, why would New York City be the place? And it just lets me know that God can meet you just where you're at,
wherever you are.
He's global.
Yes.
He is not stagnant in one place. He's international. He created this world. Yes, he created you.
Yes,
he created you. So there is no reason to feel that he doesn't love you, you know. And a lot of times it's us that walk away from him.
Exactly.
He never walks away from us.
But the thing about God, and he's so faithful, is that that's one reason why I really fools with God like that. Because he, you know, in the times where I have been unfaithful and I've turned my back on him, there, I read a post and it is so profound. It's nothing that I can do to make God turn his back on me. And when I've been unfaithful, he's never left me. He's always been right there where I left him. It's always been me turning away. And in those moments where I have turned away from him, he's always been right there like, I still got you. I still got you, because I know your heart right toward me. You just messing up. But I'm still here. So just come on back and come on back to me and let's work this out. I'm still here. I still love you. My love is still unconditional. You still my baby. I'm still your daddy. Like, come on. Let's work this out. And that's why I think a lot of us miss it, because, again, tradition and people have played church so long that they don't even know what it's about. It's and like I said, church is the empowerment zone, but it's also a training ground. You learning the word to go out and do what you got to do to win people over to Christ.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm glad that you have found a church home where you can love, you're loving it. And apparently you're growing tremendously, obviously. that's obvious. And I just thank God for you. And being obedient, because it takes a lot of guts to step out, especially to have something called walk by faith in a society where that seems like that's the last thing people want to do. And you're doing it unapologetically and you are killing it. So I thank God for you and your boldness to step out and do something unpopular and make it look cool doing it.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, you're speaking life into me right now because it's hard.
I know it's so hard,
but I feel like God has equipped me, right? Like,
definitely.
Being in New York has toughened me up. Like, it really is not too much somebody can say or do that's just like, oh, well, you know, dang, I gotta. That stung right there, like it's gonna pinch,
right?
But you can't really sting me. Right. New York does that enough,
right?
But I got my final question.
Yes,
what does walking by faith mean to you?
Ooh, so okay, I go to a word-based church, so I'm sorry, but you know, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So walking by faith is walking by a knowing. And trust. Faith is synonymous with trust. I don't know how it's going to work out. I can't see how this is going to go. But God, I trust you enough to know that it has to work out because you love me. And we live in a society now where, you know, you have to see it. Everything is right now. You have to see it to believe it. That's the saying, the old cliche or adage. You have to see it to believe it. But faith is believing without seeing. I believe you, God. I believe that what you say is true. And although I cannot feel it by my senses don't, it doesn't dictate who you are and what your word says. So I'm going to walk it out. And no matter if it looks like I'm going the wrong way, I know that you're with me. You said it in your word that you're going to always be with me. In Psalms 23, that's what you said. You are my shepherd and you're going to lead me in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. So I'm going to walk this thing out and I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it appears to be. I know that all things work together for my good because I love you and I'm called according to your purpose. So whatever the road is, whatever this journey you have me on, it's going to always work out for me. And it's a fixed fight. I always win, period. Mm. So that's what walking by faith is to me. It's going against what you can naturally perceive by the senses and stepping into a realm of the unknown, but it has to do with trust. It has to do with trust. Just like when people stand up on those, you know, and they stand up on a ladder or whatever and fall into the crowd during those trust tests. You don't know if those people are going to catch you or not, but you believe that they will. That's why you fall back in their arms. So they'll catch you. But the thing with God is he gonna always catch you. It's not a doubt in my head. It's not a doubt in my mind that no matter what it is, whether it's finances, a physical sickness or a emotional attack, a mental health attack, whatever it is, it's all gonna work out for me. And that's what walking by faith means. You don't have to see it for it to be right. You don't have to see it to you know, no. You don't have to see it to believe it. You just need to believe it. Then you'll see it.
Yes, girl. Yes. So I always end with a Bible scripture. Psalms 139:14 says, I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know that full well. So I chose that because we got somebody that's wonderfully made, okay? And I want y'all to not only support her, but just support the things that God is just producing on the inside of her, right? Like, if you see her live, tune in, right? Like, she's saying some stuff that could probably help you in whichever season you're in. And also, just right now, understanding that women empowerment people have just put such a negative connotation to it, but it's a beautiful thing when one woman and another woman can come together and not be in competition, but be in collaboration and be in community with one another and say, I know that you're doing it. And you say, you know, I know you're doing it. And guess what? We're going to come together and our forces are going to align. And we are both going to understand that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And that is not just for women. That's for men also, because you got a lot of men that may not believe Absolutely. That they are fearfully and wonderfully made, but God took the time to make you. He took the time to prepare you. Mm-hmm. Maybe you were in your mom's womb for 9 months, but he knew your plan. He knew exactly who you were going to be before you were that person. When your mom and dad did what they had to do, you know, because they had to do something to get you here. Like,
they had to do something.
They did. But I just want you to understand that it was by no mistake that you made it. It was by no mistake that you're listening to this podcast. It's by no mistake that you really do want to walk by faith in every area of your life. It's by no mistake that you really want to go back to church, even though you've had some church hurt. It's by no mistake that you have all of these visions and goals on the inside of you. And when you choose to wake up every day without a purpose, that you have not just sat down, wrote it down, saw what you liked and didn't like, and you didn't really act on it, to be honest, you have to look within yourself and say, am I believing what the word said? He already told me that I'm fearfully and wonderfully made, but am I not believing it? Because if you believed it, you're going to walk different. You're going to talk different. You're going to treat people differently. You're going to love folks.
Absolutely.
Sometimes when you don't love people or when you're ugly to folks, it's just a reflection of how you really treat yourself. So, you know, LaRhonda, I got to thank you for being on this show, because you blessed me today. You have allowed us all to catch the tea. Okay. And I look forward to your vlogs, not only for the rest of the year, just in 2019, because I know that you have something to say. And I was always like the little sister watching, but for me, I didn't have a bigger sister, right? So any woman that was older than me that I felt that I could look up to, I kept a little small. I didn't say much, but I always watch. And that's a testament to anybody. People are always watching you.
Period. Yep, I have learned that a lot. I have learned
that. So, one, LaRhonda, where can they find you on social media so they can connect with you, girl?
They can follow I have a personal page. Just LaRhonda Glover, LaRhonda Glover, or they can find the vlog page, which is Rhondafully Made, Rhondafully.
Okay.
Girl, yeah, I had to get that.
Yes. And y'all, I'm gonna put it in the show notes below in the episode too. Don't worry.
Yep. Okay. That's where they can find me. I do most of my vlogging on Facebook. I haven't got to Insta yet.
Okay. Well, listen.
Instagram is a little.
Well, listen.
I haven't gotten
the curve. When you go on there, I'm about to throw you on the gram. I'm about to throw you on Facebook. I'm about to throw you on Twitter. So you're going to be on there. You're going to be on these places, you know, even if you don't use them as much. You're going to be on there. But for the listeners, I gotta say thank you. Tune in next week, because I'm gonna continue to bring you the heat. That's what I'm gonna do every week. Y'all gonna get some of this walk by faith goodness. You gonna be convinced.
Hey.
You are going to be convinced that if you're not walking by faith, you ain't doing something right. Okay. Hey. So that's all, folks. Tune in next week for another episode. We out.
If you want more content like this, make sure you give the Walk by Faith podcast a 5-star rating and leave a review on Apple Podcasts. You can follow me on Instagram at __thePrettyPlug and follow all updates on the podcast at WBF Podcast. To those already supporting the show with a monthly subscription, thank you. If you're not already a supporter and you'd like to help make this show possible, tap the link in this episode's description or visit anchor.fm/jasmine-a-stith to become a monthly supporter. That's all, folks. Tune in next week for another episode on the Walk by Faith Show.